So what we can measure in multiple myeloma? First of all, we have to make a diagnosis. And the diagnosis is based on two most important criteria. First of all, we can determine the amount of plasma cells in the bone marrow by bone marrow aspiration. And also, we can determine the amount of immunoglobulins that plasma cells produce by electrophoresis. On electrophoresis, we have albumin band, alpha 1, alpha 2, beta and gamma band. Gamma band represents immunoglobulins. As we know, the most common protein in the blood is albumin. But in case of mutation in plasma cells, they begin to produce huge amount of monoclonal immunoglobulin that cause huge increase in gamma fraction. Such severe increase in gamma region called M spike. M stands for monoclonal. Now, the presence of less than 10% of malignant clonal plasma cells in the bone marrow that produce less than 3 grams per deciliter of monoclonal immunoglobulins called monoclonal gammopathy of unknown significance. If the amount of malignant clonal plasma cells in the bone marrow increase and become greater than 10% of all cells in the bone marrow, this will cause increase in production of monoclonal immunoglobulin, and when the amount of monoclonal immunoglobulin in the blood will be greater than 3 grams per deciliter, this condition called smoldering multiple myeloma. In both monoclonal gammopathy of unknown significance and smoldering multiple myeloma, the production capacity of malignant plasma cells remains insufficient to cause severe injury to the other tissues in the organism. Thereby, at these two stages, typical symptoms will be absent. But if plasma cells with time, due to some additional mutation, will become more aggressive, their production capacity will increase. And the higher becomes the production of monoclonal immunoglobulin, the more severe will become the clinical picture. So with time, this will cause injury to the various tissues throughout the body that will cause so-called CRAB criteria, and a condition that is characterized by the presence of greater than 10% of clonal plasma cells in the bone marrow, together with at least one of the CRAB criteria called multiple myeloma. In CRAB criteria, B stands for bone disease, because as we know, in multiple myeloma, clonal plasma cells massively produce RUNCL that stimulates osteoclast activity, and osteoclasts begin to reabsorb bone tissue. Now, the severity of the bone tissue damage we can assess by X-ray. The resorption of the bone tissue presents on X-ray as punch-out lesions. Here, for example, we can see punch-out lesion on a skull. The reason why they look like this is that calcium is what makes bones look white on X-ray. And because osteoclasts wash out calcium from the bone tissue, the higher is the activity of osteoclasts, the more calcium is washed from the bone tissue, so the darker becomes the bone area. For example, here you see an X-ray with multiple osteolytic lesions. And logically, the bone tissue with decreasing amount of calcium is less dense and thereby more prone to fracture. As alternative option, we can use whole body low dose computed tomography, which is actually the new standard for the diagnosis of lytic bone lesions. But in most regions, it's not available. Also, we can use CT, or in case of suspected spinal cord compression, MRI is a more preferable option. And the presence of one or more osteolytic lesions fulfills the B criteria. C stands for calcium, because with destruction of the bone tissue, calcium is going into the blood. And the presence of more than 2.75 millimoles of calcium in the blood fulfills C criteria. Hypercalcemia and monoclonal light chains of immunoglobulins can cause severe damage to renal tissue that can cause renal insufficiency. And renal insufficiency can be measured by blood creatinine level. And serum creatinine higher than 177 millimoles fulfill R criteria. Kidney injury causes decreasing erythropoietin production that in turn leads to anemia. And hemoglobin level less than 100 fulfill A criteria. Now, there are a couple of things that we can measure in addition to this. First of all, hyperproduction of clonal immunoglobulins causes increase in total protein count. and it can really help in diagnosis. Because in normal condition, when you see total protein count 80, for example, and then you look at albumins and the albumins level is 50, then the amount of all other proteins, including gamma globulins, is 30. But in multiple myeloma, frequently you look at total protein count and it's 100. And then you look at albumins and the albumins level is 40. 100 minus 40 is 60. So the amount of all other proteins is 60, which is significantly higher than normal. And you can suppose that this increase in total protein count is caused by elevation of exactly gamma globulin fraction. Also, by bone marrow aspiration, we can take a bone marrow sample for fluorescent in situ hybridization, so-called FISH analysis. By FISH, we can determine various chromosomal aberrations, as chromosomal translocations or deletions. For example, such mutation as translocation between chromosome 6 and 14 cause overexpression of interferon regulatory factor 4, or translocation between chromosome 8 and 14 that results in overexpression of c-Myc protein. So with this method, we can determine the etiologic mutations that cause multiple myeloma. And by discovering the subtype of myeloma, we can to a certain extent predict the course of the disease and to choose a more effective chemotherapeutic regime. Also, we can measure the amount of light chains in the blood. And in Ben-Jones multiple myeloma, where clonal plasma cells produce huge amount of light chains, the serum-free light chains level is greatly elevated. The criteria for multiple myeloma is the amount of free light chains greater than 100. But the problem is that increase in free light chains concentration may result from a number of clinical situations, including immune suppression, immune stimulation, reduced renal clearance, or monoclonal plasma cell proliferative disorders. Due to this reason, in multiple myeloma, we determine serum free light chains ratio, which is the ratio of kappa to lambda light chains. Usually, when normal plasma cells produce normal immunoglobulin, kappa and lambda light chains are produced in equal amounts, so free light chains ratio is normal. But in multiple myeloma, because malignant plasma cells can produce just one type of light chains, either kappa or lambda, increase in amount of just one subtype of light chains, kappa for example, will result in abnormal free light chains ratio. So significantly abnormal free light chains ratio occurs due to the plasma cells disorders, in which plasma cells secrete only one type of free light chains. So additional criteria for multiple myeloma is serum free light chains ratio greater than 100. Also, by electrophoresis, we can determine the amount of monoclonal immunoglobulins in the urine. And the presence of monoclonal light chain M spike in the urine, also called Ben-Jones protein in the urine, with concentration of greater than 1 gram per 24 hours, is one of the major features of multiple myeloma. Also, to identify a particular subtype of light chain that is produced in excess, we can perform immune fixation of both blood and urine. Because on a simple electrophoresis, we can see M spike. But without immune fixation, we cannot say by overproduction of which subtype of immunoglobulin it's caused. So by immune fixation, we can determine that M spike is caused by overproduction of kappa light chains. If you like content, please press like and subscribe button. All the best!